very proud, and I'll show some. These are boring, but they're grass. I won't hang around on them for too long. Is that these are the so we keep a lot of statistics because we're very conscious of buying. These are about the number of works bought by state and the galleries we buy from by state. So we keep a very close tab on who we're buying from, how much we're buying from people, and try and keep it quite representational. We're also very conscious of keeping up our male-female mix, being government. We're very conscious of that. And we also buy quite a lot of Indigenous or Aboriginal work. It's about 15% of the collection is Aboriginal work, and we try and keep that purchasing level up. It's a very interesting purchasing area because there's a lot of different sorts of Indigenous work, as you'll see as I go through and show you some slides. What I thought I'd do, having told you how we operate, I mean, the other thing too is we do have a board, an advisory board, which does help us in certain ways, and that's composed of contemporary artists mostly and business people to keep us on track in terms of business. The acquisition policy, I'll just touch on that because, as I said, we buy quite broadly, but I'll just read you just a little bit of that before I get into the slides, is that the work has to be by living Australian artists, representative and relevant to contemporary art practice, indicative of outstanding artistic achievement, including both emerging and established artists, without gender bias, illustrating wide variety in styles, media, philosophy and technique, covering all states and territories, reflective of the nation's multicultural population, representative of the achievements of Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander artists, appropriate for rental to public and private sector clients, intrinsically sound in condition and reasonably immune to deterioration in routine operations of display, packing and transportation. That last one's interesting because, of course, we don't have any control over the environment we send the works out to, so it is very important that we buy works that we think are fairly robust. And we do have a lot of problem with photography, as you realise, and light. It's one of the ongoing problems we have with these sorts of works. But that's enough without pictures because they're much more interesting. What I've done is I've just thrown up some images of works in situ. This was a great work, I think, called One Ring to Rule Them All by Michael Brennan, which is made of little tiny shopping trolleys all made together. And it's a reference to The Lord of the Rings, if you know that trilogy. And it's a comment on consumption. And this was an interesting one because I saw this in an artist-run space. And we're very conscious of looking to artist-run spaces and getting young artists before they go to galleries. But I fell in love with this work and thought it was a very difficult work. It's actually meant to hang freestanding in the room. But then the client who rented it went back, had seen it in the gallery and went back to buy it, and we'd bought it before her, and she was so disappointed and wanted it so badly she came to Art Bank and she rented it off us. So we managed to get a new client out of that as well. And she designed this whole wall and this room around that work. So I don't think we'll get that one back in a hurry, but it does look fantastic. These are fabulous. This is a young Polynesian artist. One of the things you'll see as you go through the artists and the artworks is that Australia is very much a multicultural society, and we have people from all over the world who've come there to settle, and a lot of the art is informed by other cultures, and a lot of the art really refers to people's sense of dichotomy or refers to their sense of identity and how they find a sense of identity within Australia and carry with them the elements of their other culture. This is a young Polynesian artist called Samuel Topu who works in far north Queensland, and he uses quite traditional Polynesian patterning that you'd find on fabrics, but he prints it on perspex, and he uses a printing and perspex technique. This is a great group called Anniversary Skulls. This is where we can do some nice things because this is an edition series, and we were the only institution to buy the whole series. The rest were broken up. So now at least we know there is one series in existence that we can loan, and it has already been on loan to an institution if people do want to see the entire set. Interesting young sculptor. We do buy a lot of wall sculpture. It's interesting as you go through because it's something our clients do seem to appreciate, and it's a bit of an easy way for us to work with 3D work. Young artist called Joel Nicholson. That's in a barrister's chambers. We're very good for partnerships because often they can't agree on what to buy, but they can agree on what to rent, and that can work quite well as well. This is the Australian, the High Commission here in Taipei. So if any of you have been there, this is the boardroom in Taipei. And that has Art Bank works. This is an Indigenous work, quite a beautiful one. It's very striking. That's their reception room with a work by Rodney Popel. The previous representative here was very keen on art, and he designed this new room around that painting. He came and got the painting first and then decorated the room around it. So I don't think we'll be getting that one back in a hurry either. Big work by Rodney Popel. That's in their stairwell there, which is a rather lovely work and looks very dramatic, a wall sculpture. These next few images, this is a very recent fit-out we did. This was for a terrific client called Sydney Water, who are the water body in Sydney. And they had a new building, a very beautiful new building that they'd spent a lot of money on with very good architects. And they came to us and they were ideal clients because they really took our advice. Often we really would like clients to really let us do the work for them and really do the fit-out. And make the building really sing. Often clients have their own views and don't let that happen. This client was very, very receptive to our views and came to us with a brief. All they really wanted was for a lot of the work to represent, has something to do with water. Well, what we gave them were quite a lot of Indigenous works because, as I'll mention and as we go through, you'll see a lot of Aboriginal artworks involve water because Australia is a very arid country and a lot of the most Indigenous work is about the land and the relationship with the land, and the most important thing in a dry land is water. So most of these landscape, I suppose, works they are by the Indigenous Australians are about where the water is. So we put together a terrific selection of works. That's a Beverly Cameron work. This is an interesting work. This is quite an old work of ours and big work by a very senior Australian painter called Sid Ball, who's a 60s painter, and this is one of the works we inherited early on. This works brilliantly. It's like it's made for the foyer. We were very excited to be able to rent it out because it's a very big work, and there's just some shots of it going up. But this is interesting because there it is in a previous incarnation, and you'll see this as you go through. Sometimes the same work has many lives, and that work was actually selected by a very famous Australian architect called Harry Seidler when he built the Australian Embassy in Paris, and that's it in location in the Australian Embassy in Paris. But it's since been sent back from there by somebody who thought they knew better, and we've now rented to Sydney Water. So these works have a very interesting life, travelling around the world sometimes. This is an example of private sector corporations, Johnson & Johnson, the medical corporation, with a lot of works of ours in their offices in Sydney. The Office of Film and Literature Classification, government body. I mean, I tried to give a bit of a sense of the whole range of clients we have. This is a private home with some works of ours in it as well. This was a display unit in Sydney. Often we have developers come to us and that's, they want to rent works for a display unit and display them. Very beautiful Joel Ellenberg mask on the left-hand side. The way we cost works is we rent them, the rental is based on the value of the work. So as some of our works become more valuable, the rental goes up. We now have some works over 30 years that are very, very, very valuable. And this becomes a side issue because there is a limit to what you can charge to rent a work. And currently for us, that limit is $5,000 a year. But if a work can be worth up to $300,000 or $400,000 or $500,000, and we still only charge $5,000 a year to rent it. So it's very good value. But at the same time, we tend to keep those works for embassies and important and very secure locations because it becomes a risk issue, of course, for us. The Water Corporation Perth with some fabulous floor sculptures by Elizabeth Kelly. Indigenous work from Utopia in Perth. Now, this is an example of... Aboriginal work is very useful for foreign affairs. This is the main office of the Foreign Affairs Department in Canberra, and they have. We just changed this fit out. It was 10 years old, but they do have, and they've kept a lot of these wonderful Tiwi Island poles. The Tiwi Islands are in the far north of Australia, and these are burial poles. Really, they're decorated to as part of a funeral rite, and they often contain the bones of the deceased. They don't contain the bones here, obviously in Canberra, but traditionally were used for. These are our two most valuable Aboriginal paintings. They're probably worth about $300,000 Australian dollars each. And they're in the Australian Embassy in Washington. And they're very happy with those because they're striking works and they look very, very good in the position they're in. So we did suggest they might like to change them recently, but they weren't very keen on changing them over, oddly enough. These are a few lovely shots. This is the Australian Embassy in Berlin, where I was fairly recently. It's changed over a bit now, but it gives, again, a sense of the work in situ. This is an early Gunter Crispin, who's an important abstract painter. Again, Indigenous work, Helicopter Jungurai from West Australia. I think most of the Aboriginal names will sound odd and be impossible to translate, of course, but I'll try and not mumble them. Again, Australian Embassy in Berlin, a few shots. Beijing, with the Mimi spirits on either side of the door. Again, works from the far north of Australia, Indigenous works. Boardroom. Legal firm. These are all SBS Broadcasting. Again, these are all just typical clients we have, both corporate and government. So it gives you quite a good sense. Very striking work by Rosemary Lang. A lot of our works have become very desirable, and people don't tend to let them go. William Robinson, very famous. It's an interesting point in case of William Robinson, because he was a painter that we bought a lot of early on. I think we have 130 works by him, and he then became a very serious artist. So they've become very valuable as well in the collection. And we have some beautiful examples of it. Patricia Piccinini, that's now in Sydney Water. A lot of these artists have represented Australia in Venice Biennales and these typical things. So they're quite senior and important artists as we go through. That's our most valuable painting on the left-hand side. It's hard to, with the cards and the pencils, John Brack, who is one of Australia's most highly regarded figurative painters, modernist painters. That work dates from 1980 and is, I think, last valued at about $800,000. But has since, I think it's since dropped back to six with the GFC. But anyway, corporate. I'll just flick through these. Bronwyn Oliver, very beautiful. We had that with a client, and they loved it very much. And then a very similar work came up at Sotheby's at auction, and it sold. And next thing, this one came back to us, and our client had bought the one at Sotheby's and sent ours back. So they liked it so much they bought one. I'll flick through these. It's not so... We've seen enough, I think, but I put lots up. There's a couple there I put up that you'll see the same work again, the same work in different locations. Same work again. And that work by Barra Barra, Aboriginal X-ray work, is now in the Australian High Commission in Hong Kong, in the living room. I saw it there only recently. So they have an interesting time. One of the other things we do, and I haven't touched on yet, is we put together a lot of travelling shows of Indigenous work. There's Foreign Affairs and Trade ask us occasionally to put together travelling shows of work. This was one of them. Kirapirangi. It was work from the Tiwi Islands, which are the far north of Arnhem Land, the very, very northern coast of Australia, very, very remote. These are put together for Foreign Affairs, and they tour them to all of the the embassies bid for them, and they tour the world over about three or four years. But they're always shows of Indigenous art. This is the first one we did, which was very successful, from the Tiwi Islands. These are just some location shots. Contemporary artwork from the Tiwi Islands, again, where I was lucky enough just to be.